Professor Christian Krechnen from the Free University of Amsterdam. He is a specialist on Neo-Kantianism, transcendental philosophy, broadly speaking, that means Kantianism, phenomenology, to my knowledge, right? Phenomenology, and also in speculative idealism, especially on Hegel. And today he's going to present to us a conference on Kant, Hegel, and the concept of Sittlichkeit, right? So thank you for being here, and thank you for the opportunity of hearing you here in Chile.
Well, thank you for the kind invitation and introduction, ladies and gentlemen. The theme of the conference is the public role of transcendental philosophy. I'm going to talk about that. The idea of the public role of philosophy within the framework of transcendental philosophy indeed is rather clear. We are dealing in essence with the distinction between pure and applied philosophy. Transcendental philosophy proper develops via the method of validity reflection distinct sets of principles that constitute human behavior and hence the world as a human world. Applied transcendental philosophy, as we could also say cultural criticism, Kulturkritik, evaluating the present state of culture, presupposes such pure philosophical knowledge. Philosophical knowledge of the principles of human thought and action, and with these of the ends and the measure of all actual human activity. This activity is always embedded in a specific historical context or culture. Evaluating this culture, hence, also presupposes empirical historical knowledge of culture. As culture qua result of human activity is related to validity, we just heard it too, defined by the principles of human behavior, but not necessarily valid by its mere existence, philosophical cultural criticism aims to discuss the validity value of actualizations, concretizations, or as we could also say, cultural shapes of the absolute principles. Are they valid? To what extent can they be understood as instantiations of such principles? The concrete is being subjected to a philosophical evaluation, that is cultural criticism, or as we could call it with Kant, applied philosophy. As a project of evaluating the concrete by unconditionally valid measures, applied philosophy is only possible on the basis of pure philosophy. The system of transcendental philosophy is supposed to supply us with a system of pure philosophy. From the perspective of cultural criticism, it concerns a set of validity principles that relates to the concrete cultural reality we live in. According to this model, so this model of applied philosophy or cultural criticism, I myself did some work, for instance, on the situation of the university in contemporary Western neoliberal society. The form of such elaborations is, as I said, rather clear already, but is first to deduce the idea of the university as a definitional moment of what it means to be human, and of humanity. And then in doing so, university appears as a specific configuration of freedom in teaching and research. Secondly, the present condition of the university is being scrutinized on the basis of that deduced idea of university. On the one hand, this method seems both very plausible and powerful. On the other hand, though, in recent years, I have become more skeptical towards the philosophical quality of such an approach, notwithstanding its immediate societal relevance. Transcendental philosophy presupposes, I think, a model of freedom that turns out to be intrinsically problematic. The Southwest Neo-Kantians, inspired by Fichte too, have shown paradigmatically that normative constraints are not only constitutive for the practical realm, but make up the foundation of the whole human world, of its theoretical and practical or whatever dimension, see this famous discussion on the primacy of practical reason. The distinguished realms of culture, or realms of validity, are all specifications of what could be called the fundamental axiotic, from Greek axios, value, the fundamental axiotic relation. The fundamental axiotic relation concerns a relationship between values, or laws, or principles of validity, the determinants of orientation, first point, the valuing subject, the concrete subject, as it was just called, and the result of this interaction, cultural goods. This value-determined self-formation of the subject finally concerns values intrinsically or immanently part of its own subjectivity, as it is called autonomous values. The result of forming reality according to values is culture. Culture has its determinacy as a value-laden reality and hence as a result of human self-formation according to values, or to put it differently, to ideas, to validity or reason. Culture, by implication, is nothing but the existence of freedom. This mutatis mutandis also holds for post-war transcendental philosophy. Yet, the existence of freedom transpires to be too complex to be determined sufficiently within the context of the fundamental axiotic relation, characteristic of Kantian transcendental philosophy. In essence, the general problem of the approach of the fundamental axiotic relation seems to be that it sticks to the influential idea, also guiding Kant, that freedom should be conceived of as a causal power of the subject that determines itself in accordance with its own laws of validity. The fundamental axiotic relation, therefore, is loaded with, as it is called in the discourse, but very much misunderstood, is loaded with formalism, as pertinently and paradigmatically argued by Hegel with regard both to Kant's theoretical and practical philosophy. According to Hegel's criticism of Kant's formalism, for methodical reasons, Kant does, nolens volens, not succeed in comprehending the existence of freedom. Despite the fact that transcendental philosophy aims to interpret principles not as mere formal, or not in a mere formal, but in a transcendental sense, so content-related sense, freedom conceived of as a causal power is itself characterized by formalism. In the causal relation, form and content are and remain opposed to each other externally. The very same thing applies, I think, to the fundamental axiotic relation. As the essential discussion in this respect is Hegel's criticism of Kant's conception of Sittlichkeit, morals, for now I'll stick to Kant and Hegel on Sittlichkeit. In the discussions on the development of classical journalism, German idealism and its significance, the issue of Hegel's criticism of Kant's conception of morality, including Hegel's conception of Sittlichkeit, in the standard English translation misleadingly called ethical life, think facticity from Kantian perspective, factum de vernunft, facere versus agere, facticity, would be much more to the point. It's about the existence of freedom, not about the specific moral quality of it. Hegel's conception of Sittlichkeit plays an important role in many respects. In particular, it is relevant for understanding the social nature of the self and the normativity it is subjected to. Without taking into account this social nature adequately, the actuality of freedom, and hence our human world, culture, cannot be comprehended properly. Comprehending the actuality of freedom falls short if it is conceived of in terms of contractual relationships between subjects or in terms of the moral quality of their will. There is no actuality of freedom beyond shared forms of spiritual value-oriented life. The social embeddedness of the actuality of freedom, however, has its rational character too. That is to say, it is itself a more or less adequate expression of freedom. How to conceive of the actuality, Kant would say Wirklichkeit, of freedom? I shall argue that Kant fails to conceive of it adequately due to the formalism of his conception of the moral law, Sittengesetz. In Kant, freedom of action can only be understood regarding its form and not regarding its content too. As a consequence, the determination of an action is, again Nolens Volens, heteronomous in nature. Hegel, by contrast, rationalizes the content while at the same time modifying the whole relationship between form and content. I will go into this later. This results in a conception of free action as being and remaining with oneself in one's other. Kant's conception of morals, Sittlichkeit, therefore presupposes Hegel's concept of Sittlichkeit. Let me first make some introductory remarks to sketch the background of my argument. Despite the fact that the issue of Sittlichkeit in Kant and Hegel has been often addressed by philosophers, it remains contested until today, and the discussion, unfortunately, is pressed forward not at last by the many misunderstandings that accompany it. Hegel's criticism of Kant's formalism is commonly read as follows. Kant's moral philosophy is doomed to be an empty formalism, as the principle of morals, the categorical imperative, I will just say CI, neither allows for deducing or justifying specific content-determined duties, nor to distinguish sufficiently between morally valid and morally invalid maxims, between moral validity and invalidity. Hence, CI does not supply determinations that are capable of guiding actions. At first sight, this criticism appears to be highly implausible from a Kantian point of view, because the function of Kant's CI is exactly to determine the content of the moral will. The dominant line of defending Kant against Hegel's criticism of formalism, therefore, is very simple. It just holds that Hegel has misunderstood Kant's moral philosophy fundamentally. And the strategy of Kant's defense is, as said, simple. They attempt to show both that and how CI determines the moral will, and hence that it is certainly not merely formal or even tautological. It essentially relates to content. So that's what the Kantian side says. However, this defense itself is based upon a fundamental misunderstanding of Hegel's criticism. Hegel does not at all deny that, according to Kant, CI relates to content. He denies the legitimacy of this relatedness. What is at stake here is the sense of Sittlichkeit itself. Kant's relating of CI to content turns out not to be the solution, but the problem. Indeed, Hegel's criticism of the formalism of Kant's practical philosophy is the instance of a more general, in particular, of a logical constellation. The criticism of formalism pertains to the profile of Kant's transcendental philosophy as such. Apart from taking the logical context of Hegel's criticism of Kant's formalism into account, taking this perspective also transfers the focus from the much discussed and disputed Kantian examples testing maxims by applying CI, which Hegel uses to exemplify his general criticism. The general point of Hegel's criticism is that Kant's conception of morality hinders it, Nolens Volens, from comprehending the existence, the Dasein, of freedom. As Hegel articulates it, due to its abstractness of formalism, Kant's conception of the good misses, and I think this is a very precise formulation, misses a principle of determination. That is to say, Kant's transcendental philosophy misses exactly the methodical moment decisive for Hegel's speculative idealism that sublates any externality between oppositions, namely the realization of the concept by moments intrinsically belonging to the concept itself, universality, particularity, and singularity. For this reason, form and content, or matter, or to put it more concretely and with view to practical reason, nature, drives and inclinations, and freedom, CI, remain opposed to each other externally. In comprehending freedom, Kant stops partway. Although the incriminated formalism of morality concerns a modern conception of freedom and freedom and the good, and surely is not restricted to Kant, Kant's critical philosophy does indeed represent it strikingly. The inclusion of content is the essential point. In Hegel's view, Kant's conception of freedom is developed from the start within the context of an understanding of freedom that is too limited to conceive of actuality of freedom philosophically. Constitutive conditions of the possibility of the freedom of the will remain untold in Kant's story. Now I come to Hegel's criticism of practical formalism. Against this background, it does not surprise that Hegel transformed Kant's conception of freedom radically. These transformations are relevant for understanding better Hegel's criticism of the formalism of Kant's moral law, CI. For Hegel does not only reject Kant's conception of cosmological freedom, I talked about this last time when I was here, he does not only reject Kant's conception of cosmological freedom as introduced in Kant's theoretical philosophy, also, and essential for the criticism of practical formalism, Kant's practical concept of freedom, according to Hegel, is unable to express what it means to actualize, or as Kant would put it, to realize freedom. At first sight, CI appears to be a powerful criterion that in no way allows the justification of any maxim. On the contrary, its formalism sorts maxims out with respect to their moral character. And without doubt, Kant's moral philosophy offers, in terms of content, a very rich whole of normative principles regarding anything that claims to be moral, and that's so to say the subordinate concept, virtuous or right, subordinate concepts. Kant's conception of practical reason and the formalism that is typical of it does indeed integrate content. The single and overarching moral law differentiates itself into a plurality of categorical imperatives and is on top of that and via these imperatives related to the reality of humans and the human world. At second sight, however, the sketch relationship to content of the formal CI does not suffice. Hegel holds, from a Kantian perspective, highly surprisingly, that Kant's CI fails to comprehend the reality, or as Hegel would put it, the actuality of freedom sufficiently. The reason for this far-reaching esteem of Kant, as indicated, goes deeper than mere practical or spiritual relationships. Yet the perspective from which Hegel addresses the standpoint of morality in his mature philosophy of spirit is the perspective of the actuality of freedom. If we look from the perspective of the actuality of freedom at Hegel's criticism of formalism, then we can detect a general pattern to his criticism. Although Kant's formalism integrates content, the actuality of freedom remains underdetermined as the rationality of actions is solely based upon its form. In order to grant the form a function that orients our actions, Kant de facto must make additional assumptions concerning the content. Within his model of grounding knowledge and norms critically, these assumptions cannot be accounted for in a methodologically justified way. As a consequence, Kant does not make good his own intentions, namely offering a critical foundation of human praxis. What seems to be Kant's glance on the one hand, formalism, turns out to be its misery on the other. It hinders the performance of one's duty. For this reason, the strategy of contemporary Kantians, Kant scholars, it's maybe a better word, of pointing to the relevance of empirical content for Kant's practical philosophy does not provide a remedy for Hegel's criticism. In Hegel's view, the basic structure of Kant's philosophy of practical reason is inadequate. Kant conceives of nature and freedom in a dualistic fashion. Hegel criticizes the emptiness of CI, not because CI is not related to content, but because he rejects Kant's presupposition that it is possible to deduce a completely formal law from a completely pure practical reason that nonetheless possesses sufficient determinacy to guide our actions. Kant has to make use of additional content, in particular concerning our rationality and its ends. These assumptions, however, are as such contingent, and hence by no means valid universally or necessarily. On closer consideration, CI turns out not to be the formalism it should be, according to Kant. In this context, Hegel offers the criticism, among others, that Kant determines the good merely as a task or an ought. In contrast, Hegel conceives of the basis for practical duties not only as a pure will, not only as a pure will, but grounds them in the empirical two, or to be more precise, in the togetherness of both components. Overall, Hegel rejects Kant's dualistic conception. Against this, he aims to conceive of nature and freedom, of the empirical and the rational, of form and content, and so on and so on, from the start in their togetherness. In this, this constellation is anything but decisive only for Hegel's criticism of practical formalism. According to Hegel, Kant's theoretical philosophy is characterized by formalism too. Kant always presupposes content. His critical philosophy, from Hegelian perspective, is never critical enough. Now, I will explain a bit more why Kant's formalism hinders or frustrates the actualization of freedom. Thus, the question is, how does freedom, or in general, normativity or validity, etc., gives itself existence? And remember, in the beginning, I said culture is nothing but the existence of validity or normativity or freedom. So it's a general problem. This is not to the question is, how does freedom give itself existence? This is not to say that Hegel, in opposition to Kant, and for example, presented like this in hermeneutics, intends to relativize or historicize the claims of reason. Not at all. After all, Hegel's philosophy of objective spirit is a doctrine of the existence not of any spirit, but of the free, and hence the rational spirit. Nevertheless, freedom conceived of as freedom of choice, Kant Willkür, freedom of choice of an individual self, does for Hegel not suffice to comprehend the will as an actual will, that is, as a will that actualizes itself. A conception of actualizing freedom in terms of freedom of choice by a will that determines itself conceives freedom of the will at best in regard to the form of the will. By contrast, the content of the will, which in first instance seems to consist merely of drives and inclinations, and hence of something given, nature, should be understood too as a product of its freedom. Actual freedom, the existence of freedom, is only present in the content of the will, if the content of the will can also be conceived of as a content of freedom. Only when it expresses what the free spirit that gives itself existence wants. Hegel is certainly far from making natural drives and inclinations which hinder our actualization of freedom into rational givens. That would be absurd. By contrast, he intends to achieve a concept of content that is able to conceive of the content of the will as a rational and hence as a free content. Thus, we are dealing with a problem that is, in first instance, logical in nature. The logical form of the content as something immediate, given, contingent, etc., is inadequate. So to say, the logical mode of the content is inadequate. The content must be conceived of differently in order to be conceived of as free. To articulate it with another focus, if the existence of freedom of a free spirit should be conceivable at all. Hegel captures this rationality of the content within the setting of the philosophy of spirit by elaborating a process in which the determination of the will is purified and hence freed. This purification of the determinacy of the will reaches from its extreme heteronomous external natural determination by drives to a form of self-determination that is self-determining universality, the will of freedom. In the course of this process, purification, this process, this self-determination proves to be the content and purpose of a free spirit. That's a very Kantian idea. That a free spirit comes into existence does not only require a formal type of self-determination of the will, it requires free content too. If, however, the content of our free will is rational, content is rational, then it has stripped off its immediacy, its contingency, and particularity. By contrast, the content is characterized by rational determinacy. As a result, it has become the content of a truly free spirit, a spirit that truly determines itself. The content is no longer merely an impulse, an inclination, and so forth. In short, not merely nature. Heteronomy, determination by externalities of the spirit, is typical of freedom in the sense of freedom of choice, not autonomy, self-determination, being with itself in the content. One consequence of the conception of freedom as freedom of choice is formalism. Instead of making the actualization of freedom possible, formalism hinders it. The reason for this is that the transition from the mere formal determinacy of normativity, from norms abstractly conceived of, like Kant's CI and the subsequent categorical imperatives of virtue or right, the transitions from the mere formal determinacy of normativity to concrete actions of the free spirit, that is to say, to the actuality of freedom, does not take place in a rational and therefore necessary way, but is contingent and arbitrary. Abstract norms are actualized contingently or arbitrarily, because they can only be actualized on the basis of concrete, content-determined norms, and hence norms that are situated or contextualized norms. Due to the externality of the content, no action is brought about, as the number of morally acceptable reasons for actions, or if you would say it with Kant, maxims, is just infinite. Rather, we still don't know what to do concretely. The good, conceptualized as an abstract norm, the CI in the singular and plural, that is a duty for the subject and thus functions as a determinant of orientation for our action and should be actualized accordingly, misses, as Hegel puts it concisely, a principle of determination. By implication, determination occurs outside the universality, that is, CI, as the form of abstract norms, with the consequence that actualizing the good becomes contingent, which should not be the case, of course. Our concrete actions, then, would not be actions out of freedom, but actions determined by external givens, by drives, by inclinations, wishes, and so on. Human action, however, is free, self-determined action. Due to Kant's focus on the moral quality of our willing, the problem of the actuality of freedom, of reason, moves out of sight. The existence of freedom as the existence of the free spirit, and hence of the idea in the element of reality, has to be conceived of in a different way, if it should be possible at all to achieve a Kantian moral world, a world shaped in conformity with the moral law. Kant's morality presupposes Hegel's Sittlichkeit as a sphere within which a Kantian type of moral law can be actualized. This constellation is, as I said already, an instance of a more general logical relationship, or general logical relationships. Kant lacks what Hegel calls the realization of the concept. I think this is the decisive distinction between Kantian and Hegelian philosophy. So Kant lacks what Hegel calls the realization of the concept. For this reason, Kant, in Hegel's view, offers a mere philosophy of reflection. Kant's philosophy remains a dualistic system. The one idea is the grounds for unity, which determines itself and that functions as the grounds for this dualistic system, is unaddressed, that is to say, it remains merely presupposed. Without integrating Hegel's logic, a discussion of the problem of formalism in the realm of spirit, more precisely moral formalism, walks away from its core. Because Kant conceives of reason or subjectivity as an abstract relation to itself, no transition from this universality to the particularity of specific contents is achieved. These contents, therefore, are always, in one way or another, presupposed as a given. Thus, they are contingent, arbitrary, in short, unfree. In contrast, the transition from the abstract, universal, undetermined to the concrete, particular, determined, should happen in a rational and hence self-determined of free way. This process, and this process is nothing but the realization of the concept, is the speculative development of the concept. The concept develops itself from the universal to the particular and singular, and with this development it overcomes any formalism in the fundamental and also for the philosophy of reality, decisive way. Hegel takes the problem of the original synthetic unity, Kant's problem of the original synthetic unity, very seriously and tries to solve it in a radical and pervasive manner. As a consequence, any externality of conceptual contents, including the contingency and arbitrariness this entails, is liquidated. Kant's conception of rationality as such falls victim to the criticism of formalism. More precisely, it concerns logical constellations that enable it to understand the speculative concept, the speculative concept, by the way, not consciousness, but the speculative concept as that which is eminently free and hence makes up the foundation of spiritual freedom too. So it's the foundation of spiritual freedom. The first thing that should be noticed in this respect is that Hegel rejects the foundation of Kant's practical concept of freedom, the transcendental or cosmological concept of freedom as introduced in the third antinomy of the Critique of Pure Reason. For Hegel, this concept of freedom is not universal enough to function as an opposite concept to the concept of nature. Nature and freedom do therefore not establish a complete opposition. Rather, Kant, in accord with the rationalist metaphysics of his age, upon which he draws uncritically in this point, anticipates already the practical concept of freedom of finite subjects. Against this, Hegel takes a more fundamental route. In his philosophy, as philosophy of the absolute idea, the concept in the speculative sense and in its specific logical function, that is the place in Hegel's system of logic, turns out to be that which is free. The concept, says Hegel, is that which is free. Freedom, nothing but the absolute negativity of the concept as identity with itself. Only on the basis of this fundamental concept, and you see it's a completely different concept than a concept of a finite subject that is able to determine itself to its own laws. Only on the basis of this fundamental concept of freedom can the existence of freedom be comprehended. If, with regard to Kant's practical formalism, practical reason is unfree concerning its content, then mere arbitrariness or contingency determines the content. Hence, the respective action becomes unfree. The universal ought to determine the content, but it determines it only with respect to its possibility, not with respect to its actuality. Therefore, no actualization of the good is brought about. This constellation could be made plausible by analyzing Hegel's criticism of morality in detail. Hegel shows here that Kant conceives of moral autonomy, or the good, as following a universality that is my own law as an intelligible entity, spirit or self. In Kant, however, the universal and self-determination do not coincide nolens volens due to the formality of the universal. As a consequence, the determination takes place outside, as I said already, outside the universal. And the subject is revealed to be unable to grant the good the determinacy it needs in order to accomplish an action. The moral law is only applicable by presupposing certain pre-given content-related determinations. Excuse me, I'm a bit confused now. I told you this already, so skip this last two minutes. Yes, let me continue here. So as I said, contents of a truly free spirit that brings itself into existence must be contents that are not merely given to the spirit, but are its own contents. Contents with which spirit identifies itself, contents in which spirit is with itself. Something is wrong with my print. I'm missing a page. Well, I told you this whole story already about illogical determination. So I think in a way I can maybe even conclude already. Maybe, yes. No, I think the most important things I told you already. I will just come more or less to the summary, and that's here. So, in short, the logical form of the content has changed. Instead of being in the form of nature, it has transformed into a moment of the form of the concept, freedom. Hegel certainly does not conceive of the will as something that is separated from thought. Rather, the will is a type of thought. Thought, as he says, that translates itself into existence, an impulse to give itself existence. Thought as a thinking will. Only as a thinking will is the will a voracious, a free will. As such a will, it is, and that is important now, it is a manifestation of the idea. For Hegel, manifestation is an activity of something absolute. Something truly absolute only expresses itself. Hegel's logic of essence shows in this respect that the absolute conceived of as a substance sublates itself into the concept. Consequently, Hegel conceptualizes the further development of the science of logic and the philosophy of reality as manifestations of the concept. Nature and spirit are therefore particular manifestations of the concept, and hence of that which is free. And just as the concept is a relationship between universality, particularity, and singularity, the same applies to the form of any manifestation, regardless of whether it concerns, for instance, the will, objective spirit, or Sittlichkeit. That Hegel, via abstract right, universality, and morality, particularity, finally reaches Sittlichkeit, singularity, is due to his conception of the speculative comprehension and the conception of concept and realization that belongs to it. It is Hegel's way of capturing the existence of freedom or realization of validity or normativity. Just like for Kant, for Hegel too, the free will wants itself. However, in contrast to Kant, Hegel determines the contents of the will in conformity with the logical structure or the form of the concept in a manner that the contents reveal to be necessary elements of actualizing the will. So that's the rationale. There are necessary elements of actualizing the will. The drives, which initially, from a Kantian perspective, seems to be results of being immediately determined by nature, transpire to be the rational system of the will's determination. The opposition between the moral law on the one hand and drives and inclination that have to be shaped by it on the other is a mere abstraction of truly free actions, that is to say, of freedom in its actuality. This abstraction hinders it from comprehending actions as free actions. The constellation of an abstract system of rules, abstract right, and the subject or self that determines itself formally, morality, is insufficient for comprehending the actuality of freedom. Normative content of the situatedness or embeddedness of the subject has to be taken into account. Such normative content is present in any Sittlichkeit. The existence of freedom or the free activity of the subject requires, thus, to incorporate concrete intersubjective, or as we could also say, social, determinations of freedom, social presuppositions of individual freedom, and to thematize them philosophically from the perspective of modernity, the perspective of modernity is the perspective of free spirit. The shape of concrete sociality, the shape of Sittlichkeit, is as such constitutive of our respective wishes, intentions, actions, and so forth. Only where there is Sittlichkeit can actions take place. Hegel's philosophy of Sittlichkeit is a philosophy of the facticity of freedom. In fact, Kant's first seven chapters of the Critique of Practical Reason is exactly about that. And then he immediately changes to the moral quality of the will. The first paragraphs are only about the distinction of nature and freedom. And this is what is being continued here before becoming or thematizing this moral quality of the will. So Hegel's philosophy of Sittlichkeit is a philosophy of the facticity of freedom, so to say, continuing the first seven chapters of Kant's Critique of Practical Reason. Truly free actions take place in a Sittlichkeit that itself is the product of freedom, hence in a free Sittlichkeit. The shapes of Sittlichkeit, therefore, have to be free shapes. In this fashion, Hegel determines them in his philosophy of objective spirit as shapes of the existence of the free spirit. Now, so far, this problem with the actuality of freedom discussed in terms of Kant and Hegel, but remember, I started with the problem of the a public role of philosophy, so now I have to ask, what does this whole story mean for Kant's metaphysics of morals? If one does nothing more than consider the persisting practical societal problems we are facing, the conclusion could be drawn that Kant's project of practical philosophy, the philosophy of the practical, not from the perspective of the absolute idea, that is Hegel's philosophy, but from the perspective of the practical, is just too important to dismiss. And that means that Kant's metaphysics of morals, Metaphysik der Sitten, needs to be integrated in Hegel's system of philosophy, systematically, of course. Locating a Kantian metaphysics of morals in a system of philosophy, therefore, Hegel's philosophy, therefore boils down to finding a point of thematic contact in Hegel's philosophy of objective spirit. Like in Natorp, you have to find a point of contact in the system of philosophy, the thematic point of contact. In this case, then, in Hegel's philosophy of objective spirit. For reasons of time, I cannot go into this much further, but the thorough of analysis makes clear that the relevance of a metaphysical doctrine of duties lies in its function to make the subject aware of the formal moments of his duties. It's in a way a project of Bildung, a project of education. So the function of making normative content aware is, as I said, a concern of Bildung. Within Hegel's system of philosophy, Kant's project of a metaphysics of morals, therefore, should be exposed in the content of Hegel's elaborations on Bildung. Hegel's philosophy of actualizing freedom is not practical philosophy. It is a philosophy of spirit, in particular of objective spirit, philosophy of the idea that gives itself existence. Against common interpretations, this does not imply at all that Hegel abandons the idea of duty. The establishment of a canon of duties does not at all become superfluous. This is a dominant view. That's, so to say, put aside as a Kantian type of philosophy which is irrelevant. But this is a complete misunderstanding. For Hegel, Kant's philosophy of morals does not dig deeply enough to comprehend the existence of freedom, and therefore must be overcome by a speculative conception of Sittlichkeit. Nonetheless, with this transformation of a practical philosophy in the sense of Kant, the problem of a metaphysics of morals is not settled completely. In fact, the question arises how a project of metaphysics of ethical and judicial normativity is possible within a speculative philosophy of spirit. This question, hence, concerns a supplementary issue. Hegel rejects Kant's position only as far as it claims to be an encompassing perspective on freedom. Kant's metaphysics of morals needs to be translated into the concept in such a way that its practical duty theoretical profile, that's so to say characteristic of Kant's practical philosophy, this duty theoretical profile, comes into its own in the relationship between the formal determination of duty and concrete Sittlichkeit into effect, a project that is still outstanding in contemporary philosophical research. Thank you for your attention.